हरे कृष्णा माता जी, हरे कृष्णा ऑल द डिवोटीज,
कृष्णा प्रभु जी,
हरे कृष्णा प्रभु जी, हरे
कृष्णा,
हरे कृष्णा,
हरे कृष्णा प्रभु जी,
हरे कृष्णा,
हरे कृष्णा प्रभु जी,
हरे कृष्णा।
थैंक यू सो मच। आई नो यू आर वेरी बिजी। यू वर वी वर जस्ट टॉकिंग अबाउट द प्रोटेस्ट यू ऑल डिड यस्टरडे इन इस्कॉन फार्मिंगटन हिल्स एंड यू आर वर्किंग एवरी डे। इट्स यू आर डूइंग सो मेनी so many sevas you have, yet you found time for us. We are a small community, but we are hoping that with your inspiration we'll be able to advance and increase our numbers. We need more numbers here so we can also have a temple and you know, advance more on this path. But I know that not everybody knows you, so if you allow me, I just want to introduce you to everybody. Hare Krishna, everyone. Please keep your mic on mute, and Prabhuji is, I'll pin him so that we can see. So His Grace Abhiram Gopaldas Prabhuji has graciously agreed to join us. Prabhuji is a physician. Some of you know him, some of you actually join his classes. I know Anita Mataji and myself and Nirbhay Prabhu, we join his Bhagavatam class every day. And Prabhuji also has so many other sevas, it's difficult to count them. But he's a physician. That is, you know, a huge calling in itself. And he's extremely busy. He's a householder. He's married and has his wife is also a physician. So both of them are extremely busy. But both of them are very serious on this path of Krishna consciousness given to us by Prabhupada. They're very sincere and senior devotees. Prabhuji has been, Prabhuji, correct me if I'm wrong, but you've been following Krishna consciousness for last about 15 years, I think.
We are trying for last 15, 16 years, yeah.
Yes, so Prabhuji is just humble, but yeah, he's been very sincerely following this path, and he's like I was counting his sevas, he's doing a lot of preaching, and he does those preaching on a daily basis. I cannot even imagine how he finds time. It takes a lot of commitment for that. But Prabhuji is guiding so many lost souls. I know that I came into Krishna consciousness by Prabhuji's influence. He did a course on journey of self-discovery, which we are trying that he would do again. It's a six-day course. And when I heard that course, I was transformed that I have to do more of this. And then Prabhuji said, okay, let's read the seventh canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. So we read that. And since then, it's been nonstop. We've been getting Prabhuji's daily guidance. So he does daily, he was also conducting actually in under his guidance, kids classes. And that's how Navya learned a lot. Navya advanced so much. He was learning so many verses. And looking at her, both Nirbhay Prabhu and I started learning verses. So Prabhuji has made a lot of contributions. And our household is just one example, but Prabhuji has made contributions all over the country here and back in India. His whole family has now become a Krishna conscious family. They're all devotees now. So, you know, he has been, like I was talking about the protest, he has been very openly vocal about his about how we need to protest against this violence, this crimes, atrocities being committed against Hindus in Bangladesh. And Prabhuji knows, you know, this is the right way. This is the way. This is not the true dharma where people are being mercilessly killed like that. He has such a detailed knowledge of scriptures. He has studied scriptures deeply and Prabhupada's books deeply. He understands the ascents through detailed study. So, and it has, from what I understand, it's Prabhuji's mission to advance Prabhupada's Krishna conscious endeavor and give this knowledge far and wide. He's sharing this nectar with everybody. And today he has honored us with his presence. It's presence of such senior devotees is very invaluable, especially in the month of Kartik. So please take advantage of this. Ask Prabhuji all your questions and listen attentively. And even after the class, churn everything that Prabhuji says in your mind. Think about it. But let's have Prabhuji shed some light you know, our hearts are very dark, so Prabhuji can shed some light and improve our faith in scriptures, because we keep every few days some doubts creep up. One day we'll be reading Bhagavad Gita sincerely, then next day we'll doubt. We'll start doubting our pastimes of Krishna. Sometimes they're labeled as mythology. So Prabhuji will tell us if these are real acts or real activities of Krishna, or are these mythology? Some of those things that we doubt and which are a hindrance to our spiritual advancement. So Prabhuji, please teach us how to appreciate these beautiful scriptures. Prabhupada took so many pains to compile them, but our hearts are so dark, we are not able to appreciate them as we should. We are very indifferent, and let's not waste any more time. Let's hear from Prabhuji himself. Please, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna, and thank you so much for inviting. Thank you to each one of you who are here today, and thank you for the kind and warm welcome, Nirbhupuru Natasha Mataji. So before we get started, let me just see if I can share my screen. So is everybody able to see my screen?
Yes, Prabhuji.
Okay, great.
Prabhuji, we have not chanted the Mangalacharan.
I will do that. Let me just start this. All right. So before we get started, how many people are here joining for the first time? Is there anybody who's joining for the first time? Okay.
And yes, I think there are some that are.
People are joining first time. How many people are joining for the first time, if they can share?
I think Neil Vaini Mataji, Mataji is in Memphis. She just got a set of Bhagavatam yesterday. She met us in MSF and she bought a set of Srimad Bhagavatam, which was delivered to her yesterday. She's
amazing. Congratulations. That is so good. Okay, so this topic is going, I'm going to present it as if most people here are new. Okay, so seems like you already have a lot of people who've been coming for quite some time. But the discussion here will be very basic. So everybody is encouraged to ask questions and have more discussion. So without taking much time, I'll get started, because we do have a long session today. So I'll start by offering little prayers. Om Ajnana Timirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurunmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha. Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shivasati Gaurav Vrinda. Hare Krishna 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 Hare Hare, Hare Ram 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 Hare Hare. Hare Krishna. So I was asked to speak on this topic of how to have faith in scriptures. But actually I'm going to modify it a little. I'm not going to speak on how that much, but what I'm going to focus first is why to have faith in scriptures. Because if we have a very strong why, then how will spontaneously automatically come, right? Where there is a will, there is a way. So first question is, are we really sure why we have to have faith in scriptures? So if I were to ask all those audience who've been here, seems like many of you have been coming for some time now. So maybe I can ask you, why should we have faith in scriptures? What is the reason? So who would like to answer? Everybody is coming here to attend how to have faith in scriptures, but my question is, why to have faith in scriptures? And what is the reason? I mean, our life is going okay without it. So we rather not have. Is it not? So how many of you? Okay, Anita Mataji, you want to share? Yes, please. Yes.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna.
So why to have faith in scriptures? It's because only way that we can connect with Krishna, connect with Supreme Personality of Godhead. That is my realization.
Okay. But then the next question will come, why do we need to connect with Krishna? And how do you know this is the only way? So questions like this may come. But good point, you made a nice point. Let's see what others have to say. Anybody else would like to answer? Okay, Ravi Prabhu, yes.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu, Hare Krishna, all devotee.
So nice to see you, Ravi Prabhu.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. It basic question, Prabhuji, to have to get answered. Who am I? Why am I here? Okay. So to know that, we need to have some kind of a manual to refer to. So since we have been given the scriptures, which we know it has come directly from the Supreme Personality of Godhead itself. So to go get those answers, the basic answer, why are we here and who am I? What is our purpose? Is our purpose to just come here, spend the time, and then again go back, die, again come back, or is there something else? So okay. That's my understanding, Prabhuji.
Thank you. Thank you for sharing that. Okay, who else would like to share? So this is a very open forum. Everybody can share. So Vedei, want to say something?
I think I just had to lower the hand.
Oh, you have to lower the hand. Okay. Okay, anybody else? So, yes, Sheetal Mataji, you want to say?
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna.
So usually we turn to God, most of us, in times of difficulties. So like, you know, and it's like, it's very opportunistic. Only when we are in difficulties, we turn to God. But then is there like a right way about it? And the scriptures kind of give us the light and the knowledge and the direction to how you have to remember God, you know, at any time.
Okay, very nice. Very thoughtful and deep. Excellent. Okay, anybody else? Okay, I'm hearing somebody's voice. Okay. All right, so let's go forward and have a little more discussion on this. Very important, why to have faith. Many of you mentioned that it gives us directions, helps us in connecting with God, and, you know, answer the question, who we are, why we are here, right? But what is the authenticity of some book somebody is giving? You know, one can say, "Arey, this may be written by somebody. You know, I can also write some book, something." How do we know the authenticity? How can we cross-check? Anybody else share the same question? Anybody else has similar thoughts? Or anybody wants to give an answer to this before we go forward? Okay, so let's go forward because it's a long seminar. We don't want to take too much, but if any of you want to share anything or ask any question, just put it in the chat box. And maybe Natasha Mataji, you can keep an eye, and if
questions
come relevant, you can let us know. Okay. All right. So let's move forward. So let's start with the word faith. What is faith? So we like, you know, I like to do a lot of discussion more than just one side, one person saying, and the other people maybe, you know, feeling asleep. I would like to have more interaction. So if any of you would like to say, please feel free to unmute and share. So what is faith? Talk about faith in scriptures, but what is faith?
Believe in anything, Prabhuji, is faith. Like
believe in anything. Okay, yes. Who else? Sheetal Mansi?
Prabhuji, I was going to say the same thing, just our belief system.
Okay, our belief system. All right. Anybody else? Yes.
When you believe in something or someone and you have trust in that.
Okay, very good. Belief and trust in something or someone. Very good. Or some process. Anybody else? Okay, you're on the right track. So it is described in Bhagavad Gita, 2nd chapter 41. Faith means unflinching trust in something sublime. See, if something is very obvious, that generally is taken as a fact, right? But if something is more sublime, you cannot really get it by direct perception, then you kind of have a faith. So we'll just discuss about this thing. So that is, you know, trust in something which is sublime. So even in daily life, many times we put faith in things. There's a little disturbance. I think somebody is probably unmuted or some background noise is coming from somewhere. Okay, now it's better. So let's take a few daily examples of where we put faith. So one example is here when we board a flight. We board a flight, at that time we put faith, right? We put faith that everything in the flight is going to work properly, right? We put faith that the pilot is well trained. He got his training at a good place. He has experience. He is allowed to travel. So allowed to fly. That means, so we are putting faith in the company, the flying company, whatever, Delta Airways, United Airways. And we are putting faith in all the crew and everything. So this is an example of faith, but it's at different levels. Not only we are putting faith in them, we are also putting faith in so many things, that the plane will function properly, land properly, the manufacturers who manufactured the plane, because this is very practical in daily life. If we don't have this much faith, you know, our daily life will get significantly affected, right? Like there are people who don't fly. They probably just drive because of the lack of faith. But then people call them, you know, they have a phobia, right? Because this is something which most people are socially accepting. So if you accept that, then it's considered okay. Because the percentage of harm is very less in this situation, you know, for various reasons. Any other examples anybody can give where in daily life we are putting faith? Yes, Navya.
You put faith in the fire station that if your house burns down, if your house catches on fire, then you have faith in the fire station to come.
Excellent. Very good. Yes. So you put faith in the fire station. All right. Who else would like to mention some examples in daily life where you're putting faith? We're not talking about spirituality or religion or anything, just daily life, which most people put faith.
So
yes,
we put faith in our universities and in our education system, that from what we are learning, if we go to a medical college, that we'll get a degree that will be accepted and we'll get a job based upon it and all that. So we are putting faith in that. And then
okay, great point. Yes, excellent. Faith in educational institutions. Okay, who else would like to say? Okay, yes, Ravi Prabhu, I think Vedi wants to say, yeah.
Yes, so Like when you're driving, you have faith in the person who's in front of you, that they know how to drive.
Yeah, when you are in a car in the passenger seat, you have put faith on the driver. He's not going to sleep, or he knows how to drive. He has license and everything. You know, you put faith. Okay. You don't check every time. Okay. Ananta Shesha. Did I pronounce it correctly?
Yes.
Okay.
When we go to sleep, we put faith that we'll wake up the next day.
Yes, very good. Very nice example. Thank you. Put faith. Okay, who else? So I think you all mentioned very nice examples. I'll give you a few more. So we buy something online. We make the payment first. They take the money out of our credit card or our bank account or whatever. And then the item is delivered after what, 7-10 days, something like that, or 5 days. And then people are putting faith that, okay, it will arrive, or they have charged from us, but it's not a, so this is a reasonable faith where, you know, you cross check, make sure you're making the payment on the right website and all of that. Then next is people go for haircut, right? So many people, they go for haircut regularly. At least they were going before Corona, maybe still going. So what happens? We just sit there and let these people use all the sharp instruments in near our neck, near our head and everything, with a assumption or kind of a faith that they are not going to, you know, use the blade to cut the throat. So this is how practically we live. We do so many things based upon actually faith, which is just presumed or assumed. Okay, this is how it is.
I think a couple more people trying to share, Prabhuji.
Yes, yes. Who would like to share?
Neel Veni Mataji.
Neel Veni Mataji, yes. Please go ahead.
Hare Krishna Ji.
Hare Krishna.
As we soon get up and we don't think, and the breakfast, lunch, everything, our mother cooks and she keeps us ready. We don't think of anything that, is there anything for to eat? She always thinks of our family.
So, can you repeat again? So she always take care of our family, and how we are putting faith?
Like when we get up, we don't think that what is there for breakfast. She always makes it ready, breakfast.
Oh, yes, yes. Very nice. So very good.
In our family.
So we put faith, like a child, when he wakes up, he puts faith that my mother must have cooked something, you know, and that assumption is there. Okay, very nice. Thank you. So in daily life also, we are doing so many things. Okay, yes, Rakshita Madhuji.
Prabhuji, faith in doctors. When we,
yes,
you know, well, you know, in the operation theaters, we just surrender that, you know, they are going, yeah, to save us.
So this is a good example. Actually, I wanted to include, but because of lack of time, I didn't. But Krishna's arrangement, it came up that many of us, we go to the doctors. Has anybody checked their degree? That, oh, first show me your degree, whether you are from a, you know, bona fide place or not. No, we put faith. We put faith, oh, this person, you know, is hired in such and such hospital, Cleveland Clinic, Mayo Clinic. So he must be, you know, bona fide for any hospital for that matter. and this is a lot with faith. In fact, many people, they have such strong faith in medical field, they don't hesitate. If the doctors say, oh, you have to go for a surgery, they don't hesitate. They say, yes, yes. In fact, sometimes the parents may be a little hesitant if they have to go for surgery. But the kids, they have even more faith. They say, no, 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 mama, you should go for the surgery. You should go, you know. And they don't know, ripping open, anything can happen, you know, to the body. It's not necessarily that 100% of the surgeries actually have 100%, you know, sure shot success. It's not the morbidity and mortality is zero. It doesn't work that way. But we are trained to have that blind faith because of various reasons, right? And educated faith is necessary, that you understand that, okay, there is a downside to go for this particular medicine, this particular surgery, or this particular vaccine for that matter. And then, you know, you have certain
risk you may be taking, but you have so much more benefit. So you say, oh, no, benefit is more. So I'll go for this. So that is how one has to decide. But people put faith in so many of these things because that is how we conduct ourselves on a daily life. And this is the fact of life. I mean, we can't really negate this. So we are using faith even in daily life. And faith has to be reasonable faith, educated faith based upon knowledge. So knowledge can be of different types. Knowledge can be material knowledge or spiritual knowledge. So material knowledge, as we know, is needed, is helpful for the sustenance of the body. And we get it for school, colleges, helps us in getting better jobs and to earn our livelihood. Spiritual knowledge, on the other hand, is different. It is actually for elevation of consciousness. It helps us, in really solving many of the problems of life, which otherwise cannot be solved by material means. So spiritual knowledge, the question comes, how should we get spiritual knowledge? So some people think we can get it by speculating. You must have heard some people say, mere hisab se to aise hona chahiye. Because I feel like this, this is how I feel. So the people speculate and they assume that what they feel is the right thing. So that is speculation. So one, some people think that's how we can get. Some people, they discuss with friends, relatives, what heard from parents. They, based upon that, they come up with something that, oh, mere pitaji ne mujhe ye bataya tha, ye hota hai. My mother told me this. Something they may have heard from different places, mother, father, based upon that, or TV. I watched in this program. This is what it is. So this is how people come with some spiritual this thing. And then some people come it by mutual consensus. And most people, according to them, this is the belief system. Most Hindus do this, or most Muslims. So they come by mutual consensus or by majority or voting or democracy. So the question is that if you have to get knowledge of medical science, you join a place which gives medical science, like medical college, and you learn from them, and then you become a doctor by training. But for spiritual knowledge, which is even more subtle, we take it very cheaply. We just do it by speculating, by asking friends, or TV and all these things. So we have to question why we have so much faith in these things, in speculation, in television, in things coming from friends and others. Why do we really have so much blind faith in these things? This is a question we have to ask. So this blind faith, we should doubt. One has to have educated faith, calculated faith, reasonable faith, and not blind faith. The problem with Indian society is they could not differentiate between calculated faith and blind faith. Because they could not differentiate it, people went to two extremes. One extreme, they believe in everything, whatever nonsense comes. The other extreme, they believe in nothing, even if it is calculated spiritual knowledge given to them. So we have to decide this. And we'll do it in this seminar, how to approach such a situation, how we can approach it. So knowledge can be acquired by different means. In Sanskrit, the words used are three. One is pratyaksh praman, one is anuman praman, and one is shabd praman. So these are the three means of by which, we can get knowledge. So first is pratyaksh praman. Pratyaksh means which is evident, which is self-evident by seeing or by perceiving or by, experimenting. We can get to know. So most of the knowledge we receive by scientific experiments is pratyaksh praman, or which we can get evidence from by material scientific gross experiments. But how we are doing those experiments is we are perceiving them by our senses. The pratyaksh praman is really important, actually. It helps us in knowing so many things. Scientists did so much discovery. If you remember, if any of you are, you know, in the similar time period, like as old as I am, you may remember that in the past, communicating even someplace outside the city was not so easy. Now we can communicate just with a touch of a button and send messages everywhere. But previously, people used to have to write telegraph, and that telegraph, each word will cost you money. So it used to be very short. And then you had to send from one place to another. It'll take some time to go there. And if you want to send a letter, which is much cheaper, then you send it, put it in the post box. It'll take several days to go to another city. Could even take weeks if you have to go to another country. And even the telephones, it was way more expensive to communicate. And when you had to make a phone, I remember you have to book a trunk call. I'm talking about 30 years ago, right? Trunk call people have to book. Anybody here familiar with the word trunk call? Yeah. So some of you can remember. And then when the call, you book a trunk call, you have to put it down and then wait for them to call you back. And then they will call you back, and then you pick up the phone, and then the voice will be so low, so you have to shout, "Hello, Anji," as if you are, you know, directly your voice is going to go there. So those days were there, and just by scientific improvement, advancement, so much technology has changed that now we can practically talk for free, right? With all this internet and everything, people talk the whole day, video conferences and so many things we can do. So technology definitely has advanced. And many of this is actually using this knowledge. But can pratyaksha praman go to the highest level and can give spiritual knowledge? For that, we have to see it is based upon sense perception. So are our senses perfect? This is my question to you. Are the senses perfect? No? Okay. Can anybody tell why senses are not perfect? I mean, what is the problem? I can see everything, whatever is there. I can feel, I can, you know, hear. Yeah, I'm hearing everyone. So what is the problem with the senses? Okay, let's start with Navya.
In our eyes, we can only see like up to a certain limit. Like we can't see too far away from us.
Very good. So eyes are not perfect because we can't see too far away. Okay. All right. Okay. Ansh wants to say something.
You can't hear from really far away.
Okay. Yes. You can't hear from really far away also. Very good. Who else would like to say? I think some other kids were raising hands too.
Were they sharing?
Well, I was basically going to say what they said, but...
Okay, know. What else is the limitation of the eyes? Like, anybody else can think of any other limitation of the eyes?
Yeah, like my entire family, except for my mom, we all wear glasses because there's something wrong with our eyes.
Good, yeah. So eyes are not perfect because, you know, you have to wear glasses many times, many people. Okay, yes. Sheetal Manji?
Hare Krishna. You can't see in the dark either.
Excellent. So our eyes are so much dependent on the circumstance that you just turn off the light or little darkness and they will stop working. So they are so much in right condition, only they will work. Okay, who else? What else about the eyes?
Okay. There's just certain spectrum that we can see of colors, and same for sound, like there is only a certain frequency that we can hear, then there is ultrasound and all that, but X-ray is an example that we can't see, but you know, that's, things are there. So
excellent, very nice. So actually, if you go and study the whole spectrum of electromagnetic radiations, it's huge. There is a different frequencies are there, from infrared, means red below red, the frequencies, right? And ultraviolet, which are more than violet. All these different frequencies are there along with the visible spectrum, but we can only see a very narrow range of the visible spectrum. Other frequencies the eyes cannot perceive. So infrared, X-rays, ultraviolet rays, all these things we cannot see. So eyes are like very limited. So what about ears? Ears also, Nirbhay mentioned, ultrasound. We use it all the time. It's actually sound waves. I'm sure many of you have heard the word ultrasound, right? Everybody has heard, right? Ultrasound is like a test. You go to the hospital, they do it for you. So what happens? They are sound waves, and they throw the sound and then perceive it and see what's going on in the body. So our senses, we can't even hear those sound waves. So ultrasound, infrasound. So like this, those things we cannot hear. Any other limitation anybody wants to tell about the senses?
Like dog whistle, we can't hear.
Yes, we cannot hear. You know something called as dog whistle? Sometimes what people do, if they are very much, you know, upset from the neighbor, they will get a dog whistle and they'll blow it, and that will irritate the dog. So the dog will keep barking at night. And what will happen is the neighbor can't sleep because the dog is barking now and he doesn't know why. So people do these kind of things also. Okay. Who else?
Mentioned in the chat that we can't see viruses, bacteria, germs.
Very good. Excellent point. Who mentioned this?
I just thought of that.
Very nice. I see a lot of messages in the chat, but I don't know if any of them, they are sharing anything. I didn't see the messages actually.
Where they shared that hearing also gets impaired, so people have to use hearing aids.
Correct. Very nice. So that is true. So Pratyaksha Praman, based upon the senses are imperfect. So because they are imperfect, then we cannot. There are few other problems. So these are the problems with the senses. We just touched on some. But there are other defects which human beings also have. What other defects are there? We'll talk about it. You want to say something? Mm-hmm. Yes.
It's about senses.
Senses?
You can't understand what animals say.
Very good. Yes. Thank you. So many times we say seeing is believing. So seeing is believing. We can't see air, right? Does it mean air doesn't exist?
No.
No? So we don't see so many things actually. And sometimes we see things abnormally. Like for example, if you go in front of a curved mirror, then the person appears distorted, maybe a fat or thin. And then another example here is given is when you put a pencil inside a cup, it appears to be broken.
Bended.
Yes. It appears to be either bent or broken. So these are the few defects, imperfect senses. So our imperfect senses that we kind of discuss. Second is we get illusioned. We'll talk about this also. Third is we commit mistakes, and fourth is cheating propensity. So we all will see how these things are applicable to all of us. Okay. So second is to be illusioned. So let's talk a little bit more about this. So we already discussed the first one, so I'll not spend much time in this. They are just mentioning how
different senses are imperfect. One point here mentioned is if you take something sour, or sorry, if you eat some sugar and then you eat orange, the orange, even though may have some sweetness, but it'll appear sour because you just now ate some sweet. Okay, so who can see the triangle in this? Can anyone see the triangle in this?
Yes, Prabhuji.
Anybody else can see triangle? Okay, all right.
Yes, Prabhuji, I can see.
So many of you can see the triangle, right? Right? Okay.
Yes.
Actually, there is no triangle. There are only three circles, and each of the three circles have a slight wedge which is taken out, and they are placed in such a way that there appears to be like a triangle, but actually there is no triangle. So this is how the mind is interpreting it. The mind is able to see a triangle, but actually the triangle doesn't exist. Okay, how many people do you see in this image?
One. Five people.
So who will tell which five are there? Some people are able to see three, some people are able to see. Let's give someone else a chance, you know. Okay, let's see who has not spoken would like to speak. Anybody who has not spoken so far would like to speak?
Vinita, would you like to?
Vinita. Okay, Vinita, can you tell what all people you see from this?
Hare Krishna. So I see two people looking at each other, and then inside those two people, on their side profiles, they're people, and then on the person on the right in his head, there's a person.
So total, how many people do you see?
Five people.
So one is the old man and old women, right? And then within their faces, there is a young man playing guitar, and there is a young girl, I guess.
Yeah.
And from the ears, there is someone coming out of the man, correct?
Yeah.
Very good. Thank you. Okay. So how many people do you see in this image? Okay. So Avni wants to tell?
There's like a old witch lady.
Uh-huh.
And then there's a really young woman in there too.
Wow, very nice. You were able to spot it. Did you see this before? Or
yes.
First time? Oh, okay. All right. Anybody who's seeing for the first time?
Yes, I'm seeing for the first time.
Okay. Those who are seeing for the first time, can out of those anybody tell how many people you saw? Who is seeing for the first time? Okay, so let me ask, who is that? Chaitanya? Is that Chaitanya? Chaitanya, you want to tell? Whom are you seeing? Your mic is mute. We can't hear you, Chaitanya.
Go ahead and tell what you're seeing.
The witch is chanting.
Oh, a witch is chanting. Wow. Okay. Do you see only one witch or do you see anybody else?
I see a child with her.
A child with her? Okay. All right. So who else has seen first time? Vinita, you saw first time? So how many people do you see in the image?
Just one.
Okay. So can anybody who is seeing for the first time see two people?
No, I can just see one. I'm also doing it for the first time.
Okay. All right. So now those who already can see two people, can they raise their hands? Okay, Vedehi, you want to tell how two people are there? Can you explain to them?
So in the young lady, which I'm pretty sure most of y'all are seeing first, her jawline, that's the old lady's nose. And yeah, when her neck is there, that's the old woman's like mouth and chin area.
Very good. So nicely you explained. Amazing. So now everybody can hear, can see two. Is there anybody who can't see two now? See the, you can see my arrow?
Yeah.
So this is the nose of the young girl. And this is the nose of the old lady. This is young girl's nose. Okay, never mind. You'll get more. So let's go to this one. So if you, can anybody see this moving? Right? It appears to be moving, right?
Yes.
It is actually not moving, but it appears to be moving. So all these are examples of getting illusioned. So this is the second point, that we get illusioned. Okay, can you see this moving? Just try to move and you'll see this moving. Yes. Everybody see this moving?
Yes.
So this is another example of getting illusioned. Okay, now fix your eyes on this dot at the center and move your head back and forth. Can you move back and forth?
Yeah, it's moving.
Now you see the circles going round and round?
Yes.
Okay, so this is another example of illusion. Okay, which is the tallest one among these? Who will tell?
None.
Okay, Navya, which one is the tallest? The one who is extreme right, extreme left, or middle?
Extreme right.
The one on the farthest side, third one.
Okay, who is saying extreme right is the tallest?
I think Prabhuji answered Sheetal Mataji's father. He just answered extreme
right. He said extreme right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Anybody? How many of you saying the left one is the tallest? Anybody who can say the left one is the tallest? Okay. So this is another example of illusion. All three are of same height.
Mm-hmm.
All three are same height, but it appears because the lines, their distance is getting smaller. So you're thinking that the right one is the tallest. Okay, can anybody see the bridge? Can you see the bridge?
Yeah.
Yes, but actually there is no bridge. They are actually the clouds in the sky and the ships are going and it appears to be like a bridge. So you saw the examples of how we get illusioned, right? So we already discussed about two points. One is imperfect senses. One, we get illusioned. Now third is how we make mistakes. Now this we don't have to actually go into too much details. I'm sure anybody here has done any mistake ever in your life? Okay, only Abhishek Kumar Prabhu is the one who has not done a mistake, I think. Everybody else? Oh, okay.
All the mistakes.
Oh, okay.
No, Prabhuji, okay. Little bit like something like that. India, Pakistan, match going on, World Cup. So.
Oh, distraction. Okay, thank you for being able to join in spite of all those obstacles, right? Yes. Very grateful.
Everything is going parallelly, so no problem.
So here we can see how these people, they are actually everybody, we make mistakes. So obviously you know, we will make mistakes even when we try to get any kind of experiment, any research or anything. And many times in the researches, you will see they account for such things. They already say that there are errors, there are biases. There is a different, you know, whole study of biases in research also. So we know we make mistakes, right? So I'm not going to go into too much details, but here there are a few examples of how scientists were thinking wrong. They're coming to wrong conclusion by mistake. They initially thought brain is probably just, you know, head is there because surface area is more, so it can cool the body, or pituitary gland or master gland there. They were considered vestigial organs like that. And then there is cheating propensity. There is propensity to cheat. So because of cheating propensity, many times people come up with their own different kind of
ways to cheat.
Different kind of, you know, conclusions, which they want people to believe. Like, for example, when in India, how many of you are here from India? So has anybody heard of the Aryan migration theory? How many of you have heard the Aryan migration theory? So Sheetal Mataji knows?
Mama's facing around.
Sheetal Mataji, want to tell?
Prabhuji, I don't know the details, but I've heard about it.
Okay. Ravi Prabhu, you want to tell?
Well, I'm like born here, but we were taught like about it in history.
In history, okay. All right. So do you know what it is?
People, they told us how like the first civilizations were like the Indus Valley civilizations.
Okay, okay, good. So Aryan migration theory was a totally wrong and cheating concept which the Britishers started. When Britishers came to India, they discovered the richness of the culture and civilization. And they studied Sanskrit and the Sanskrit Vedas, and they saw in Vedas there is a mention of Aryan. Aryans are those who are learned people, who are very, very advanced civilization. So they started telling that, yes, Aryans are very learned people, but Aryans are not the ones which are in India. Actually, Aryans are the ones which were in Europe. And they migrated to India many, many centuries ago. And they are the ones who have come up with all these beautiful scriptures, beautiful work, beautiful kind of a structure of the whole Indian civilization, or Indus Valley, Harappan, and all the other things which were good in India. Practically, they were from the Aryans who migrated. And the local Indian here have forgotten. And that's why they have got into blind faith. They have got into different other things. So now Britishers, we have come here to again revive you back to the Aryans. So Aryan migration theory was a cheating thing which they concocted back in those days. And the foolish thing is that it has already been proved wrong, but still it has not been removed from many of the books of history in India. And they're still teaching in Indians even after like 70, 80 years now later. So anyway, this is cheating propensity. So even in many of the historical remains, there are different points mentioned, which are actually some of these are already discovered. They are actually done to misguide the people. Give me 1 second. So these are the few points which we can see. Pratyaksha Praman is not 100% solid because it has problems. We have four defects. And because of these four defects, the conclusion which we come to from Pratyaksha is not sufficient to get the knowledge about God. Does it make sense? Is it making sense to everybody?
Yeah.
Yes, Prabhu.
Okay. So we'll go to the next
Vedi is sharing in the chat about the Aryan migration theory. It was also mentioned with Hitler and how the Aryan race was the perfect race.
Yes, very good. So that's why Hitler named his own Germans as Aryans, because they took a lot of Vedic scriptures and read them, and they understood, okay, Aryans are the superior people. So then we are Aryans. So then that's how the Aryan word started having a negative connotation in the Western media and the Western world, because they link it with Hitler. Then second is Anuman Praman. So first was Pratyaksha Praman, evidence. Anuman Praman means guesswork. That this must have happened, that must have happened, we guess. Like many times, if you see life cycle of a star, you know, they teach in schools. So life cycle of the star, how do you know? I mean, you don't sit there and watch the whole star from the beginning to the end, right? Because the star lives for so many millions and millions and billions of years, right? The humans don't have such life. So they observe different stars and then they conclude that, okay, this star, this much have happened, this. And because this is so much guesswork, this knowledge keeps changing very fast. They come up with new things. Oh, no, this is new thing, which we never knew. There are different new waves they are catching from the universe of different heavenly bodies, radio waves, sound waves, like that. So a lot of guesswork is there. That is Anuman Praman, Anuman Lagana. So this example is of how six blind men were asked to go and touch an elephant. They had never seen an elephant. They were asked, just go and touch one point and tell, what do you think elephant is like? Everybody has heard this story, right? Six blind men and an elephant. If everybody has heard, I will not spend much time. No, not many people. Okay. So these six blind men, they were asked, okay, go. They had never seen elephant in their life. They said, okay, go and touch the elephant. Touch a part of the elephant and tell about what is your opinion, how the elephant looks. So one person, he goes and touches the, trunk of the elephant. And he had not felt, he had not seen elephant before, but he had seen a snake. So when he felt it, he felt, array, this feels just like a snake. So elephant must be like the snake. So he concludes elephant is like snake. Then another person, he touches the tusk of the elephant. And then they are very pointed, right? Pointed. So he thinks, maybe it's like an arrow. Seen an arrow before. Another person, he goes and touches the belly of elephant. And he thinks, this looks like strong, like a wall. Somebody is touching the feet. He's thinking, this is like a trunk of a tree. So elephant must be tree. Another person is touching the tail. He's thinking, elephant must be like a rope. So like this, all these men, they had not seen the elephant, but they came to a conclusion of how elephant is just based on one part. They did not go and touch every single part of the elephant. Just by one part, they came to a conclusion. This is Anuman. This is guesswork. This must be like that. So this is not going to be a sufficient. Is this a good way to understand how the elephant is?
No.
How many of you think it's a good way? No, not a good way, right? So similarly here, we're very, very short of time. So I will be showing only a small part of the video, which I wanted to show. So I'm going to show you something. So scientists, they mention different things about the time period or how the humans came and how, you know, different, how the origin of the life was. So they actually many times don't give the correct picture. So I'm going to share something here. This is a scientist who actually discovered so many factual things which is not corresponding to the current modern theory, which says that humans came into being just 5, 7, 10,000 years ago or 15,000 years ago. So he actually shared how this is not true and humans were there even millions of years ago, and he proved it by many of the astrological findings he had. Can everybody hear it? Can everybody see it and hear it?
Yes, Prabhu.
In the fall of 1994, Michael Cremo, co-author with Richard Thompson of the highly controversial book, The Hidden History of the Human Race, embarked on a three-month nationwide television and radio tour to publicize their work. At the same time, a highly rated nationwide television program was aired dealing directly with the theme of their book. In the last 150 years, a mass of scientific evidence proving that people like ourselves existed millions of years ago has been systematically suppressed by the scientific establishment. The following are excerpts from these shows viewed or heard by more than 20 million people. Why would thousands of artifacts be ignored by mainstream archaeology? They show the unthinkable. Images of man battling with dinosaurs. Reptilian creatures interacting with men and women. Ancient inscriptions on stones depicting complex surgical procedures. And carved metallic spheres found in rock strata 2.8 billion years old. This evidence points to one conclusion, that the history of life on this planet may be radically different than what is accepted today. In this program, The Forbidden History of Man, we will examine documented evidence which suggests that our theory of evolution needs to be completely revised. Much of this evidence has been known for hundreds of years, but it's been ignored because it directly contradicts theories which are universally accepted. We will hear reports from a new breed of scientists who have been labeled heretics for daring to challenge fundamental scientific theories. In their controversial book, Forbidden Archaeology, Michael Cremo and Dr. Richard Thompson have revealed a major scientific cover-up. Since the beginning of archaeology, researchers have found bones and artifacts showing humans like us existed hundreds of millions of years ago. But according to Thompson, these discoveries have been suppressed, and we have come to accept a picture of prehistory that is largely incorrect. Thompson and Cremo have documented hundreds of cases which tell a gripping story of a scientific world shrouded in conspiracy and deception.
Darwinian's theory of evolution. Is that correct?
Yes, Gary. Essentially, that theory says that human beings like us have been around for about 100,000 years. And before that, you would have had only ape-man-like creatures, before that, apes and monkeys. What we found, however, when we looked into the entire history of archaeology, my co-author and I did 8 years of research. We looked at every archaeological discovery that's ever been made. And what we found is that there are hundreds of such discoveries that indicate human beings like ourselves have been around for literally millions of years.
Okay, so this is a long video, and I just wanted to show that this is a amazing work he did after many, many years of research, and showed us how there are so many evidences that actually humans or human-like personalities existed millions of years ago. And I can share the link with everybody, and you can watch this later. But the point I was making is that sometimes, because of various agendas, cheating propensities, the facts are not analyzed properly. So we'll go back to our... Okay. So humans and monkeys and different other species actually existed simultaneously. That's also geologically and scientifically shown. Okay, so Pratyaksha and Anuman we discussed. What is the third one here? Shabd Praman, which means hearing from authority. So this Shabd Praman or hearing from authority is practiced for so many millions and millions and millions of years. And this is extremely, extremely helpful. Even it is practiced in modern times. Let's say if somebody wants to study something, he goes to the authority. For example, somebody wants to read about medicine, a particular subject of medicine. So he goes to that particular, you know, professor who has written books on it, or buy one of his books and read those books, which are called as authoritative books. So that way you hear from them, so you don't have to do all the research which they already did, and you take it forward from there. So similarly, in spiritual life also, you hear from those who already know, who are trained, who have seen, and they can show it to you. Otherwise, you will not be able to get success. So this is Shabd Praman. So Shabd means scriptures, means of course the people, but then the people will give you the books. Like if you meet someone who is spiritual or who has good knowledge of spirituality, they will give you the books. They will tell you, okay, read the Bhagavad Gita, and then he'll explain to you. So this is how you get more and more understanding on the scripture, on the spiritual life. Just like we have sound waves which take the knowledge from one person to another, similarly scriptures are the books which takes this knowledge from one generation to another. So why scriptures are considered important or valid or authority? Because first of all, our other means of gaining knowledge, they are not perfect. So first of all, we have imperfect senses, we are illusioned, we get illusioned, and Anuman Praman is not good enough an evidence. So the remaining is the Shabd Praman. So here we have the manual, just like when you get a gadget, let's say you buy a watch or you buy electronic computer or TV, then you get a manual with it. The manual actually shows how you have to operate this piece. So it's very important that we understand that scriptures are manuals which came when the earth was made and when the living entities were came into being. So they were given this knowledge. Similarly, the example is how a gadget is made. The manufacturer of the gadget gives all the information of how to operate the gadget. Similarly, this world, how we have to stay in this world, how we have to interact with this world is all given in the scriptures. And how do we know? How do we put faith? That we'll talk now. So scriptures are like axiomatic truths. What is an axiomatic truth? Can anybody tell axiomatic truth? How many of you've heard of Pythagoras theorem? Pythagoras theorem, right? So Pythagoras theorem or any other theorem for that matter in mathematics is accepted because it's already proved once. It's accepted now as axiomatic truth to solve so many other problems. So it is already solved once. It's not that every time you prove the Pythagoras theorem before using it, you just take it and then use it. Similarly, the Vedas, their authority, authenticity, we can get in the beginning, we can understand it once, and then based upon that, we can understand the Vedas or the scriptures or the Bhagavad Gita. So that's axiomatic truth. And there are so many predictions which were made by the scriptures, and they even make predictions for future. So all this is very helpful. So let's talk a little bit more about them. So manual, like here, washing machine came. So along with that, you know, the gadget, the point came. Then axiomatic truth, we already discussed. Vedas don't need proof. They are proof in itself. And then many of the things which Vedas talk about are there, are now proved in modern science. So Vedas talk about how cow dung has properties which can be very helpful, positive, and can be beneficial. They have antibacterial properties, anti-cancer properties like that. There's mentioned about cow dung, cow urine, and things like that. Then our scriptures talks about how the earth is bhugol, which means the earth is like a sphere. But this was not known to the modern people even till few centuries ago. There was a debate. Some of the scientists in the Western world, they were thinking that maybe the earth is not not round, but is flat. Even right now, there are videos of Muslim clerics speaking on the mic that people are cheating. The earth is flat. Even now, recently I heard one Muslim person was telling in his madrasa or wherever, these people are cheating. And he was logically trying to prove how this earth is flat. So this is how the confusion was there. But we see in our scriptures, there was no such confusion. They knew his goal. Even when you see Varaha Dev, his picture, you see the Varaha Dev picked up the earth with the tusk and it was round, right? Okay, so in Vedic culture, there is no denial that all plants, animals, everyone has life and how every living entity has to be respected. In fact, the plants are very much respected also. At night also, we don't disturb the plants. But if you see, this was only scientifically discovered about 100 years or so ago. Before that, they did not have this concept that plants have life. Jagdish Chandra Bose, he did a lot of experiment on this and proved. This is about embryology. How third canto Srimad Bhagavatam talks how the child in the womb at different time period develops different parts of the body. When the hands develop, feet, and everything. So I'm just going to show a short video on this. Anybody watch this video where it's given at different time period, how different body parts are developing? Anybody? No, not seen. Okay. So we'll play it right now.
What is the next body you are going to get? must have information.
So what happens on the first day, fifth day, 10th day? Everything is being explained here. Hare Krishna. So because of lack of time, I'm stopping this in between, but I'll share the screen, the link with all of you, and you can watch it later. But the point here is that scriptures are so specifically describing all these details. I mean, how did they know back in those days when they didn't have any of the, let's say, gadgets or any of these instruments? They were not able to do ultrasound or any of that. So how they were able to still tell about so many details? So this is a question which we can't answer unless we put faith on the scriptures, how they are not coming from an ordinary, mundane living person. They are coming from somebody who is much higher. They're the word of God, actually. So we have very few minutes, so I'll go a little fast now. So this is just basically telling how different time periods, different scientific theories kept changing. But the Vedic truths, they never change. We see the application of the Vedic knowledge even right now. Yoga, meditation,
Vastu Shastra, astronomy, they all have their significance. Astrology, they have their own significance. Talking about astronomy, we see how the knowers of Vedic science, they could actually, they can predict eclipses. When the eclipse is going to happen, they can accurately predict. How they can accurately predict? They don't have all the, you know, gadgets, telescopes and all of this, and they have been able to predict it for so long. So that means the model which they are having has some sort of an authenticity to it. We see the beautiful architecture and metallurgy science, how developed it was, that in India, the famous Qutub Minar has a big pole made of such a steel iron which never rusts. It doesn't rust. So their metallurgy was way more advanced to have you know, all these things. And the scriptures have done a lot of predictions for the future. They have done a lot of predictions. In the past, they predicted 5,000 years ago, these books were written. And these books are commented upon at various time periods. So for example, around 200-300 BC, we had great, you know, commentators, Vishnu Swami and others, they commented on Bhagavatam. So we know the Bhagavatam dates back to thousands of years. And at that time only it was predicting about how in future Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu will come. It is predicted in the 11th canto, 5th chapter, 32 shloka. And we can read it and see, yes, this is very much talking about him. He talked about Lord Buddha, who will be coming. So talked about Chanakya. Chanakya is, you know, mentioned that he will be coming. King Ashoka. The different shloka specific quotation is given where. Then in Jesus Christ is, you know, predicted in Bhavishya Puran, Atharva Veda also. Prophet Muhammad is also predicted. So like these things already are being predicted in our scriptures. So obviously, how will they get to know about all these things without having the knowledge of future? So they could see, because these books are not written by ordinary people. They are actually apurushaya. Apurushaya means who are written by those who are not ordinary purush, ordinary living entities. They are beyond it, higher knowledge. So Shabda Praman means hearing from the right source. In the Srimad Bhagavatam, first canto, third chapter, fourth shloka, Prabhupada writes in the purport that in the material world also, we do not always see things with our own eyes. We sometimes see through the experience of those who have actually seen or done things. Like for example, how many of you have been to Japan? How many of you have been to Japan? Here, anybody? How many of you have a doubt that Japan doesn't exist? Anybody here who has a doubt? Okay, maybe Japan doesn't exist because I did not. So you didn't go there. You didn't see Japan. You are making your knowledge based upon what you heard, read, or had an experience of talking with someone else who've been there. So similarly, spiritual world, you may not have been there, but it exists. You can talk to those, like the great souls who appear from spiritual world, like Srila Prabhupada came. So those people who've been there, those books which describe about them, there are maps which talks about them, how the Golok is, Vrindavan is. Similarly, you know, material world, like what we are talking, we have to doubt the doubt. When a doubt comes, we have to doubt the doubt. What we do is, we very intelligently think that when a doubt comes, we actually take pride in it. And because we take pride in it, and we think that we can counter what is being said in the scriptures, like this, we will not get the knowledge. One have to have a submissive spirit to be able to understand what is being said. And in that submissive spirit, with intelligence, one has to question. And with that question, one will act with a submissive spirit, one will be revealed what the truth is. That's why these are called as revealed scriptures, not heard scriptures, not seen scriptures, no, revealed scriptures. Somebody says, oh, show me God, then I will believe. But what is the guarantee that you will believe if we show you God? Duryodhan was seeing God, but still he was not believing. Ravan was seeing God, but still he was not believing. So such arguments people gave that show me God, they are actually, there's no guarantee that they will see. And then we already talked about how they are proud of their senses of seeing, which is imperfect. So one has to hear from the right sources and one have to base their knowledge and their approach in the same way. So all these are different ways of acquiring. We already discussed Pratyaksha Praman, Anuman Praman and Shabda Praman. So which one of them is best out of the three for gaining the knowledge of the Lord? The third one, right? Shabda Praman. So Shabda Praman comes from one generation to another. Like for example, I was talking about Pythagoras theorem. Now Pythagoras theorem, whenever you hear from a teacher, it is going to be the same. It is not that it's going to, no. In America, they have a different Pythagoras theorem. In India, they have different. It doesn't work like that. It's the same thing, right? So similarly, the spiritual knowledge is coming from one generation to another, Principles are the same. Practical application we have to learn from the guru in our life. So here we see the whole parampara, how the knowledge was given by Krishna to Lord Brahma, Brahma to Narad Muni, Narad Muni to Ved Vyas, and so on and so forth. It's coming to Ved. So like this, it's not that ISKCON is the only place where you find this knowledge. There are so many such places where pure knowledge is given, but that doesn't mean every place is giving pure knowledge. No. You'll find good doctors, but you will also find quacks. Quacks are those who portray themselves to be doctors, but actually they are not doctors. So when you have the knowledge, you can differentiate between who is the good doctor, actual doctor, and who is just a quack. If you don't know anything, like, you know, Dehati, Gaon people, they don't know who is who. Anybody has written their name and then MPCH next to it. Oh, it's a doctor, MPCH, some degree, never heard about it. And then you go there, they are just compounder at some place. They have opened their own clinic in the village now. So those are quacks. So similarly, there may be so many people who may be having their own organization and different things going on, but they may not be bona fide. We have to understand from the scriptures what is the bona fide parampara, and then we have to identify. And of course, proof of the pudding lies in its eating. So when we read the scriptures, when we associate with devotees, we start actually getting transformation of our heart. Our questions start to get answered. We feel the transformation from what we were to what we are now. We start seeing that from, pride, we get humility now. We were proud, but now we are becoming humble. From becoming exploitative, we are generous. From being self-centered, now we are selfless. We are service-oriented. In we don't want to get service, but we want to give service. So all these positive qualities start developing in us when we follow the scriptures, when we follow the parampara properly, nicely. All this actually helps in increasing our faith in scriptures. All this actually helps in understanding how this spiritual life is so very important. So practical application will be that just like scientists observe the phenomenon and come to conclusion and, further ascending process is going on. Like that, we will not be able to get the real knowledge. Even Lord Brahma could not figure it out. When he was born, he was in darkness and Lord gave him the Vedas, the scriptures. He accepted, he learned from the Lord, and then he used it and created this whole creation. So similarly, we must take shelter of those who are more serious, more advanced, more experienced than us, ask them questions, then finally approach a bona fide spiritual master who can actually train us. And we must read these daily to develop faith. We have to read them daily in association with devotees, ask questions intelligently in a submissive spirit, and associate with those who have faith. If we want faith, we have to associate with those who have faith. And we have to serve the great souls. In Bhagavatam, it said, Shushusho Shraddhanasya Vasudev Katharuchi San Mahat Sevaya Vipra Punya Kirtan Vishevanath. So, which means that one can develop the taste for hearing scriptures, chanting and reading about the scriptures, knowing more, having more faith. How we do it? When we serve great souls, engage in the service of great personalities who are engaged in service of Krishna. And then there are 9 processes of devotional service, which, you know, we have to follow, then our faith will increase. So 9 processes, the details you can learn from Natasha Mataji and Nirbhay Prabhu. Then association of devotees is extremely important. So association includes taking shelter of spiritual master, associating with senior devotees, sharing with equals with those who are new, rendering proper service. Then there is a shloka, yasya deve prabhaktir yatha deve tatha gurau tasyaite katata hi tatha prakashyante mahatmana, which means that actually it's here, only to those great souls who have implicit faith in both the Lord and the spiritual master, all the imports of the Vedic knowledge are automatically revealed. So all these things will be revealed to us if we have faith in the spiritual master and the Lord. And how we develop that faith? By association, by inquiry, by asking questions, by learning. See, there is no scope for blind faith here. Everything is based upon scriptures, is by question and answers. Arjuna also in Bhagavad Gita asked questions and answers, right? In fact, Bhagavad Gita 4.42, Krishna is saying, doubts which have arisen in your heart out of ignorance should be slashed by the weapon of knowledge. So gaining knowledge is extremely important. Discuss this one. And then ignorant and faithless persons who doubt the revealed scriptures do not attain God consciousness, as they fall down. For doubting soul, there is happiness neither in this world nor in the next. So this is Bhagavad Gita is saying that we have to kill the doubts, actually. Cut the doubts. How we cut the doubts? By gaining knowledge. Because if we keep the doubts, then they will hinder and we will not be able to go back to Godhead. So here is beautifully mentioned. Scriptures are like Srimad Bhagavatam and Bhagavad Gita describe Krishna's transcendental pastimes. And just by hearing about those pastimes, we develop our faith in Krishna. So how we develop it? By reading, by hearing. Okay. So thank you very much. We'll end it here. if devotees have questions or anything, we can take that. I'm sorry if it took too long, but just wanted to do justice because it's a big topic.
Hare Krishna. Thank you so much. It was such a riveting, very, very helpful discussion, and gave very wonderful examples and slides and videos with the help. You pretty much cleared all the doubts, but there are some doubts that I'm sure we all have, and I saw one in the chat that was there. So if you'd like to take some question answers.
Yes, I can take questions.
Prabhuji, one Sabina Mataji, is it right, is mentioning Hare Krishna Panchang Pranam. They said the earth is going around, but scriptures say it is not. So I think it is talking about how in the astronomy it is said that earth is revolving around the sun, whereas in the Vedic knowledge, it is the other way around, that the earth is central and other planets are revolving. So please answer.
So this is a good question. So I want to make it very clear here. The understanding of the earth going around or sun going around is not that that one is over the other, but actually it is what the scriptures talk about is the relative motion. And in the relative motion, you can choose to keep one as the center point for discussion sake. So let's say if you keep sun as a center. Now, sun, obviously, you know, from modern science, you can say, in making a thing simple, we say sun is the center and things around go around. But actually, the center is the center of gravity. So everybody is rotating around the center of gravity of that particular, you know, set of objects. So if you see Earth and Moon, so even though one can say the Earth is, you know, in the center, Moon is going around, but actually both are going around the center of gravity of the whole thing. And the center of gravity lies much more closer to the Earth than to the Moon. So therefore, in one sense, it appears to be, you can see actually when two stars which are equal in mass or almost equal in mass, when they are rotating, it actually looks like they are rotating around something and actually is the center of gravity of them. So similarly here, when they talk about in the scriptures, Earth being center, that is the relative motion. They are taking Earth to be the center for their audience to be able to understand the whole subject. So it's time, place, and circumstance in which this relative motion is actually being talked about. Does it make sense?
Yes, Prabhuji. Sabrina Mataji, if you're available to comment, if that answers your question. But Prabhuji, there are books available.
We can have more discussion separately because this is, you know, more specific to a particular part.
Prabhuji, can you mention, since people are interested in this Vedic astrology, can you mention, I know that there are several books, because Vedic description of our creation is different from what science.
Yeah, there are books on Vedic cosmology. There are a few, maybe we can share with you the links and then you can, you know, get it from Amazon and other places and that.
Please, everybody, clarify your doubts, ask Prabhuji, any questions about why to read scriptures? Do you think you will start reading after this seminar? And or those that have been reading, if they want to get better in reading, how to have more faith?
So I think everybody is hungry because the seminar went for too long.
Mataji is asking something, Prabhuji. Mataji, go ahead.
Who is asking?
Anita Mataji.
Yes.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna. So, Prabhuji, I had this question, like in this age of Kali Yuga, where we are not very much self-realized, at least I'll talk about myself. And we know our scriptures are really vast. It takes time to read and then to absorb. Like even by reading, we don't understand in one time, probably, you know, we have to read again and again to understand. And then, you know, like we have to search the association of devotees to get the actual understanding. So this whole process is time taking. So I heard like it takes like 26 years, like somewhere it took to complete the entire Bhagavatam to read in the group. So this is one part. Whereas the attack of Maya, like, you know, all those things that we have so attractive in this material world, it's approaching us very faster, like. And by the time we realize, by the time we complete our scripture or like, you know, we reach to certain level, we are already spoiled. We are already attacked. So how can we, you know, combat with such problem? And then also like how we can increase our speed of goodness, like, you know, how we should increase the speed of reading and understanding the scripture so that we are kind of immunized by the attack that we are facing from the material world.
Excellent. Thank you very much. So Mataji asked beautiful question. She's saying it's the age of Kali. And in the age of Kali also, so lifespan is less, memory is less, intelligence is less. Scriptures are so vast, learning them, even if we read them once, we may have to read them again. And our speed of reading is also not too fast. So if we wait for all these to happen and the meantime, what about the attack which Maya is doing to us? So that is why we don't depend only on reading of scriptures, actually, because reading of scriptures will take a long time. And it's not a mechanical process that, let's say, if you want to become a doctor, unless you finish all these books, you cannot become doctor. You know, that's how it is going to be. Or engineer, you have to finish all these books and learn. But spiritual life is not like that, actually. Prabhupada said you can become Krishna consciousness very fast. Dhruv Maharaj was 5 years old. And he was given a process by Narad Muni. He followed the process and he could see the Lord face to face. Prahlad Maharaj was in the womb. And there itself he became, just by hearing, became totally Krishna conscious. So therefore, what the scriptures do is make us very, very favorable and increase our consciousness and transform our heart. But that is not the only thing we do. We engage on various level and we attack the attack of Maya. So Maya, when it is attacking, we have to attack beforehand. We cannot start assuming that we'll attack later. So chanting is very, very important. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Chanting means we are calling for the help of Lord. When we are calling for the help of Lord with seriousness, intensity, then we'll be very focused. Just like when we are drowning, somebody is drowning, he'll call for help, help, help very intensely, loudly. Similarly, when we are when we realize that we are actually in miserable situation and we need help, help of higher powers. And then when we take shelter of the Lord, of the holy name actually, which is non-different than Krishna, then the holy name protects us and the protection is immediate. How holy name does it is going to be Krishna, in Krishna's hand. You know, how you do it, your problem. My problem is that I want to serve you. I want to love you. I want to be in the shelter of you. That is what I want. Just like a child, he doesn't care. He doesn't care. I am hungry. Mother has to figure out how to feed. That's mother's headache, not child's. Child's only thing is he wants to be with mother, right? If child is with mother, mother will, he doesn't have to, you know, take the stress and the tension of how I am going to get my, you know, food. 2-year-old child, he doesn't even worry about any of that. So similarly, a devotee never worries about how Krishna will treat me. He only wants to be in association of Krishna. In fact, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, whether you leave me brokenhearted or come and embrace me, that's up to you. You will remain my Lord birth after birth. So this is the commitment of a devotee, that Krishna, however you want to treat me, it's up to you, but I want to only love you. Just imagine when somebody loves you or expresses the love in this way, how much attracted you will be to that person. Let's say your own child comes and says, Mama, I love you. So how much we automatically want to reciprocate with that feeling. So similarly, when we are chanting, we are calling for Krishna, we are actually expressing our love and gratitude to Krishna when we are chanting. That is the way we can actually charm the heart of Krishna. This is a secret. Not many people know this, but only devotees know. And devotees can share it with us. And if we use that, we can actually get the secret password of going back to where there is no misery, no problem, no trouble, nothing. And we even can take so many others with us. So this is such a rare science. And because somehow or the other, each one of you in the conference call is very special to Krishna, very special. He wants to personally give you this. And that is what he's doing in these regular conference calls. Each time you're coming, Krishna will never forget that you kept all the other engagements aside. Today there is a match, India-Pakistan, but still many of you are here. So that means Krishna is taking a note that you gave Krishna preference over that. Some people could not come because they could not give preference to Krishna. For them, this is preference. And Krishna takes notice of all of this. And because you sacrificed all of this to come to Krishna, Krishna will make arrangements. To the intensity we desire to read the scriptures, to that intensity, Krishna will really reveal the scriptures to us. If we really desire, I want to read these scriptures, Krishna will actually reveal it to us. just by mere mechanical reading cover to cover page, the scriptures won't be revealed. They will be revealed by how our attitude is. Are we humble? Are we service oriented? Are we selflessly wanting to serve Krishna and Krishna's devotees? If yes, we are on the right path and these scriptures will be revealed. The faith will come automatically. The obstacles will go away and you will be able to complete them very fast. I know some devotees who completed the Srimad Bhagavatam in 6 months. The whole Srimad Bhagavatam first reading, 6 to 7 months. So there are people like that also. But you're right. It's such a big book. Most people will not be able to do it even in 5 years, you know, for that matter. So it's not going to be based upon how much scriptures you read. It is based upon what your attitude, how your attitude is changing, how much you are eager to learn, how much you are eager to hear and chant. Does it make sense?
Yes, Prabhuji. Yes. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Anybody else would like to share?
Anybody else, please ask your questions. Yes, Sheetal Mataji.
Yes, Hare Krishna Prabhuji.
Hare
Krishna. Question that I had was regarding the discussion that we had earlier about the Shabda Praman.
Mm-hmm.
We say that Krishna is the absolute, that is our understanding. And all the words spoken by him in the scriptures are absolute. So in the discussion in certain places, like say in chapter 6, 47, where Krishna is talking to Arjuna about the Ashtang Yoga, you know, he says towards the end, like who is a yogi? And then he says, this is my opinion. So when he says in certain sections that this is my opinion, how should we understand whether, why is it not like it's my absolute thing? Ye aisa hi hai.
Yeah, this is a very good question.
Yeah.
Yes, Mataji, this is a very good question. Actually, Krishna is very, he's a kind-hearted, loving father. And he is not a hard-hearted Hitler or dictator. That this is what it is, that's it, have to do it. No, he is giving you the choice. This is my opinion. Because there are people who are not interested in Krishna. Okay, that's their choice. And then there are people who are interested. Those who are interested, they will take Krishna's opinion as seriously. They will say, oh, Krishna is so humble. He's just saying, it's just my opinion. This is the height of humility of Krishna. Does it make sense? Okay, your mic is mute, I think.
Yes, Prabhuji, yes.
All right, great.
That is what it's like by example, like Bhagwan hoke bhi jaise itne humble hai.
Exactly. Yeah, this gives us something to strive for, because sometimes we become very much demanding. No, this is how you should do it. And then we realize, arey yaar, Krishna is saying this is my opinion. Then why you are trying to become, you know, so much funne ka? Baitho chup chap. So this is how Krishna is. All right. Who wants to ask?
I think Namita Mataji is asking.
Yes, Mataji.
Hari Bol Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna.
Not a question, but just wanted to give a little more what Anita Mataji asked. I think I had the same feeling, you know, living in a Kali Yuga. But the way you explained it, I think it may really make sense. And I love the fact that how you said it, you know, how your child comes and says, mommy, I love you. And, you know, you automatically, you know, you go to your child. So I really think that's a really good example, at least for me, to react, you know, how if you go to Krishna, he's automatically there for you. You know, he's gonna take you under his shelter. So I think that really opened my eyes. And I think that was really what we all needed to hear. So thank you for sharing that.
Thank you very much. So this shows that this process is actually very personal. Just like a child and mother, they are so personal in their dealings, you know, love, affection and everything. Similarly, our relationship with Krishna is very personal. It's unique. It's something which nobody else shares with Krishna. our relationship with Krishna. And therefore, Krishna actually expands himself in the form of Paramatma and is there in the heart of each one of us. Makes sense. Thank you very much for nice comments.
Let's see if Anita Mataji, are you asking another question? Or
Yes, Mataji, if nobody is asking and if we have time, I would like to just ask one more.
Sure, I don't see any other hands raised, Mataji, so go ahead. Prabhuji, do you have time? Because
I'm okay. I can stay.
Okay, yes, Mataji.
Thank you, Prabhuji. So the other question I had, Prabhuji, is specifically for the students who are in, student life now, like somebody is completing MBBS or like, let's say, our kids, they are in like ninth grade or certain level of education where they have commitment for the studying their textbook. And oftentimes I get this complaint that, hey, you are asking me to read the scriptures every day. Then when do we read our own textbook? Like when do we read our read for the exam? So what advice you would give for those students so that they can include our scriptures in their daily life?
So advice will obviously be for the parents, not for the children. So first advice for all the parents would be that everything we are cooking at home should be offered to Krishna first. And if you offer everything to Krishna and children eat only what is offered to Krishna, that is the first step. If we can feed our children with Krishna prasadam alone, then that prasadam will do the trick. So this is the first recommendation, that everybody, we should cook at home nice items which the children like and which are can be offered to Krishna. Offer it to Krishna with love, affection, devotion, and teach children also how we can offer this to Krishna and then taste. So every time if they know that this has to be offered to Krishna, then that is first step. And then the second step is intense prayers to Krishna. When you do intense prayers and you offer them prasadam, that is very nice. And then depending upon how your time, place, situation is, Krishna will reveal how you can add Krishna consciousness to their life, chanting, reading, hearing, all these things to their life. Krishna will connect. Many times they may be attracted to kirtans. So you can play kirtans at home, when you are cooking or when you are, having some time when nothing else is being played at home, just play kirtan. The more you can play or play lectures, the more you do that, the more things will go passively in their mind. And that way, they will actually pick up a lot of things which you won't even realize. So that would be my recommendation.
Yes, thank you, Prabhuji. But yeah, those who are staying away from the house, like hostels, so for them, we should be just praying and...
So those who have gone out of your house are totally, gone out of your hands now. So you can only talk to them like friends, a friendly way, just like you talk to any other friend for preaching and cultivating, same way, because they love you, they have affection. Prepare as much prasadam as you can, which is dry prasadam, which is not going to go bad, and give it to them from time to time, send it to them. Prasadam is very powerful, very important. And then see where their interest is. We have a lot of videos in simple, easily understandable way, which can be relevant for them and they can relate to that. So it's very important to see what their situation is and then relate it accordingly. Does it make sense? And then of course, have strong friendship with them. If they feel that you are having strong friendship with them, then they will want to please you. And if they see that you have attraction towards Krishna, then they will do something like that, which will please you. Maybe, on few occasions to begin with. Does it make sense?
Yes,
thank you. So those are a few words. Of course, I know many of you may be having better ideas or better suggestions. Natasha Mataji, Nirbhay Prabhu can contribute more.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. If nobody's asking, I'll ask a question. unless somebody is ready. Okay, so probably mine is more mundane. I'm going back to like pratyaksh praman, not so much, let's say, a new person who's not in Krishna consciousness. So couple times I get this doubt that I don't know how to answer. So, you know, we are, science has progressed so much in Kali Yuga. We are using so many technological advancements made by the science, right? In anything, I mean, cars, planes, cell phones, internet, computer, and we depend on these things a lot. So we are depending on the new discoveries of the scientists a lot in our daily life. And we see by pratyaksh praman that they help us, that our life would have been very primitive, medieval without them. It has made our life very easy and comfortable. But on the other hand, in scriptures, you know, we see all these fantastical acts being done by people that cannot be replicated anymore. And we are always told that this is the influence of Kali Yuga, or these are the leelas of Krishna, like, let's say, Hanuman lifting a mountain, things like that. So many acts that are described in scriptures are very fantasy-like, unbelievable almost. So when our people in modern world tell us that, okay, this is mythology, and these same people are giving us these new comfortable advancements, technologies, then it is very easy to believe that, yes, those scriptures are just mythology and these things actually did not happen and this is just blind faith. So how do we reconcile all these ideas? And
So if I understand correctly, so they, in the pretext of scientists being able to achieve something which is helpful, why, I mean, how is that having a connection with scriptures being bad?
Like in those
times, being mythology. Because let's say scientists are doing something which is helpful, why this credit is being given to those who are asking this question from us? Are they scientists? I mean, many of the scientists, like Einstein, for example, was very God-conscious, used to read Bhagavad Gita and stuff, right? So he did not say that Bhagavad Gita is a mythology, and he did so many experiments. But this new person who's coming, what is his credential? How many things he has given us to be able to question that this is, you know, mythology? So that's first thing. Second thing, mythology means myth. Myth means which is not a fact. The scriptures actually are not mythological. They are historical facts. I mean, somebody compiled them. Ved Vyas wrote so many books, or for example, in the recent times, so many other personalities, Krishnadas Kaviraj, Goswami, he wrote Chaitanya Charitamrita. Such a masterpiece of just from literary work itself, how those poems are written in Sanskrit, it's like, and they're reciting and everything from literary level also, they are very, very high class. Those people who don't have any such idea can comment on these things in weird ways, but who want to waste time hearing their comments? So the problem is that because India was subjugated by Britishers and prior to that by Mughals, a lot of the Indian culture was actually denigrated and, you know, represented in a wrong way. And all those who were blindwashed by such false propaganda are still continuing it and hiding behind such a propaganda. They are actually closing their eyes to the very fact of all these different things which I mentioned, how scriptures did so many predictions. They talk about so many things. For example, reincarnation. It is another 2-hour seminar which we can talk about reincarnation. But, you know, scriptures talk about them. Time travel, I did not include. I was trying the seminar not to go too much further. But there are actually evidences which suggest about time travel in the scriptures. Or for example, test tube baby, how they, you know, made. So there are a lot of such examples. Now talking from a different perspective, you mentioned some of these things cannot be replicated now,
actually, there are so many yogis who can do so many things, even right now, which scientifically we'll have difficult time in proving. Like there is a yogi, I'm sure many of you may have heard in news and other places, they show that this yogi has not eaten anything for many, many years. I think there was a news channel, India TV or someone, they invited this yogi, kept him there in there, this thing for 10, 15 days to see if he's eating, drinking or doing anything. And he was not doing anything and his energy was still having no problems. Many of the yogis, they can, you know, they can lie flat on so many nails, a bed full of nails, they can lie there, the nail doesn't pierce them or does nothing happens. So like that, there are so many yogis who could do things. Some yogis can make you know, gold, or they can produce ash out of the hands. So many things they can do. Actually, it's not just illusionists, like magicians, which we talk about, they are illusionists. They know how to do it. But many of these yogis, they have powers by which they can do these things. And they are all material powers. There is nothing spiritual about it. But at the same time, they use mantras and different other things, which, you know, the scriptures talk about. I'll give you another example. This person, I can probably share the videos with you. So there are certain techniques which the kids are trained to use in their ashram. And by these techniques, even if you close their eyes with cloth and everything, you put a lot of things in front of it, still they are able to see and read what is there in front of them. So this is all based upon the scriptures. They learned such techniques. Now these are not spiritual things. They are all material techniques which are not on the level of material modern science. This is from scriptures, from mantras, different ways they have evolved these powers. Does it make sense?
Yes, Prabhuji, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Let's see if anybody else, if not. There are a lot of new names that I see. Please unmute and ask any questions that will help you eliminate your doubts. If not, Prabhuji, we'll do one other session one day, whenever you're available. But if not, you can type it in the chat box or send it to our WhatsApp group, wherever you got the information from for the class, and we can get some answers.
You all want to see, I can show you one more clip of something which we just talked about. I mean, I know time is running, this is just going to take 2 minutes.
Okay, sure.
Or I can share it. Okay.
I'm in Varanasi.
Everybody can hear?
Prabhuji, can you increase the volume? Yeah, we can hear.
I think none of you have seen this thing before.
Now?
So take my word for it.
Everybody can hear now?
Yes.
I am here with some young students of Swami Nityanand who have their third eye awakening achievement, which means according to our traditions, there is a third eye and it can be awakened as a siddhi. So these are young people who have had a third eye awakening experience, and they will demonstrate it for you on live camera right now. So I'm going to ask you to please explain how this thing works, and then we will have a demonstration.
So the third.
So let's just go to the demonstration first because of the lack of time.
Which is called the Agnya Chakra 21-25. Because of this third eye awakening, our relationships, how we are able to make decisions. This is not only in children, it is in children and in adults. So anybody's third eye can be awakened. And Paramahamsa
is absolutely black and dark. So you want to put this on him?
Yes, please. So now he's going to be, you're going to write something. You can write whatever you want.
I'll write something. So this is what I wrote. This is what I wrote, and I'm going to hold it. How far do I hold it? This is good enough?
Hello to everyone.
That's very good. So should I do another one?
Yes, sure.
Okay.
So the ability to see without using our eyes. So you see using the third eye, and just like how our regular eyes function, you're able to see. That's the specialty of the third eye. Activation is one of the aspects of third eye.
Okay. This is the thing I wrote. Okay.
This is Varanasi.
Very good. Excellent. So we'll have more people?
Yes.
So now you can remove it. I want to ask him questions. What is your name?
Brahma Sukha Maharaj.
And how old are you?
30.
And how long have you been doing this?
A year.
1 year. So when you see this, do you see it in color, like original,
yes,
black and white? You see it in color. Now you were tilting like this one side. One eye is more than the other, or one head, the vision, or what? How is it?
It comes, as you practice, it will come as 360 degree. So as you practice more and more, it will appear in all places.
So right now it's in some place, but as you practice more, it will happen more places. Excellent. Thank you so much. So we'll go to the...
So basically he is going to show in so many different students this, and not just this, there will be another techniques they can see and tell about things. So all these are, you know, yoga practices by which different, you know, apparently supernatural powers can come, but these are, you know, mundane powers. The scriptures don't talk about them as spiritual. These are just, you know, powers which will be beyond what modern scientists are able to discover so far. Does it make sense?
Yes, Prabhuji. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Okay. So thank you very much, everybody, for inviting. Very, very grateful to all of you. Please, I am very inspired by Natasha Mataji, Nirbhay Prabhu. Please stay in association with them and regularly attend. And if I can be of any service, please let me know. Stop here.
Can we thank Prabhuji by chanting Hare Krishna Maha Mantra loudly, please?
Thank you, everybody,
for joining. Hare Krishna. Have a nice day.